Hello, my name is Renate McNay and you're watching Conscious TV. My guest today is Katie Davies. Hello, Katie. Hello. Katie wrote a book, Awake Joy, and we are going to talk with her about her life and her journey and her work. So Katie, the first question, it's actually on in front of the book I have, is what is the essence of enlightenment?
It's always and forever here. It's who you are. And in fact, that is the only essential question, is who are you really right now? Mm-hmm. As we're sitting here, enjoying one another, you know, what is deeper here? The essence, rather than the form identity.
Right. Mm-hmm. When I read your story, I read your book over the last days, and before you awakened, you never asked yourself the questions, who I am. Your awakening just happened, spontaneous.
Yes, I had never heard of awakening. Yeah. I'd never heard of enlightenment.
Yeah,
I'd never meditated.
Yeah.
But in retrospect, I can see that as far as the life situation is concerned, that there was this natural opening along the way from the time of being very tiny, becoming present in the body through the type of business that I was involved in.
Yeah.
And
would you tell us which business that was?
Well, originally I was a French teacher.
Yes.
But the changes started occurring when I opened this aerobics business. Mm-hmm. And I had been in dance my whole life, and with the teaching of the aerobics, there had to be a inward focus, not really inside, but of how the body feels and moves. Mm-hmm. And so the shift was from outside to sort of inside.
Yeah.
Not really the, what I call the inside of the inside. But, and I try to share with people that virtually every moment, just ordinary life, is showing us the way. The teacher is everywhere, it's life itself. And if we would just pay attention to it, especially when we're awakening, we tend to separate out a satsang experience or being with a teacher.
Yes.
And then leave that moment and enter ordinary life. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that teacher's within us always, but it's also presenting itself constantly. If we can be present and open, really open to the unknown.
It's just so easy to forget to be present.
Well, the mind wants to.
The mind comes in and takes us away. And
yes, and it, you know, it's such an ingrained habit, yeah, living that way.
Yes.
Your entire life, of course. Yeah. You know, we have lived with this primary delusion of being this separate sense of self ever since our parents, you know, taught us to point to the body and say, I.
We were programmed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. And then that individual sense of self projects itself as constantly in time, yeah, never, hardly ever present.
Yes.
Unless there is some beautiful circumstance.
Yeah.
Where the veil falls away a bit.
Mm-hmm.
But it's only a habit.
It is, yeah. Mm-hmm. A big habit.
Yeah.
So everything started in an aerobic class you gave, and you had a runner's high. Mm-hmm. Could you explain what happened?
That was actually not an unusual experience. It was,
yes,
rare.
Yeah.
And I'm sure many of our listeners have experienced that. And I need to point out also that there's nothing causal in what I'm saying, that a runner's high did not cause this or that. But whenever you are present in this manner and the mind drops, in that particular instant, everything shifted into slow motion.
Yes.
And perhaps if you've ever come close to an automobile accident, or you know, maybe during one of these the latest trend of trance dancing, there's this every time warps and slips into slow motion, and just beyond that thin and almost trance-like veil, you know, the pure eye of this divine is actually courting you. And if you're caught, you know, it's a miracle. This isn't something that, and it's you.
Yes.
It's not something that you need to search for and find. It's quite helpful to step out of time.
Yes, but you also mentioned in the book that being doing all this aerobic, and you were a ballerina, and you worked for many, many years with your body, that this was important in your opening, or you felt then that this was important.
Yes, in retrospect, I do feel that, and continue to, that the body is of primary importance. It is a wonderful tool for stepping out of time.
Yes.
The false mind-made self into the body, because the body is always here and now.
Yeah.
So if you're conscious of it and fully feeling it,
in other words, if you inhabit your body,
yes,
which a lot of us don't do because we are so caught up here.
And then referring to that aerobic stay.
Yes.
Suddenly there just emerged this mysterious and profound sacredness that well, seemed unbelievable to the mind. It was almost like I was sensing a new dimension.
Yeah.
And as you can imagine, that made me intensely alert. You know, what is this?
Yeah.
And out of the blue, in a single instant, I was swept completely out of the body.
Yes.
And was falling. You know, this is just the story that we're speaking of here.
Yeah, but the fascinating story.
Through this amazing stillness.
Yeah.
And then all conscious experience vanished.
Yes. So you were reabsorbed by the Absolute, I guess. And your body, you said...
I was fully who I am, beyond consciousness and beyond unconsciousness.
Right.
And when consciousness reappeared, I was no longer sourced in the body. Mm. You know, here I was with a business named, an aerobics business named Body by Katie. And in an instant, I had neither Body nor Katie. You know, it was quite bewildering. I had no idea what had occurred. The body was somehow far above me and seemingly unaffected.
So there was
and
no
still teaching aerobics.
And there was no reference. You all of a sudden didn't have any reference point.
Right.
So how was that? Yeah.
Well, there was this profound sacredness that I am, a deep stillness, an ecstatic bliss, which eventually just becomes a calm joy that is ever present. It's who I am. It's who we are. Essence of who we are.
Yes.
Regardless of what's taking place in the life situation, regardless of what's happening with the body named Katie and the life situation, it's always here. We don't have to attain it. It's ever present, and it's caused by nothing. How could it be? It's already here. And we speak of eternal joy. Well, if it's eternal, it certainly must be here now.
Yet we believe we only can realize that by grace.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is an interesting question that you're pointing to.
Yeah.
Because as soon as there is a practitioner who is trying to become something or to realize in the future something more of who they are, you've moved into time and experience. And that's how we have really gone about life and everything. We would like to learn German, and so we take classes and we learn how to conjugate the verbs and all of the vocabulary, because in the future we want to speak. Well, this is not the way to go about enlightenment and awakening. It's become more fully aware and conscious, first, of what is already here. But at some point, it will naturally shift to that personal reference point, I. Who is that? Yeah. Is it true that it's pointing to the body only? Mm-hmm. Who are we really at the core?
So the question is, who am I? Like, yes. Raman Maharshi.
Yes.
Said, yeah.
And I've used that in the teachings frequently because it is so successful. You know, it's not a particularly a method, and it's not a question that you ask intellectually or philosophically, you know, who am I?
Mm-hmm.
And then think about it. The secret to it really is that even though that is just a word like any other word.
Yeah.
That ego I, is an altered state of consciousness and therefore has within it is pure consciousness.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
And so when we're willing to just leave me and my story alone for a little while,
yes.
You know, in the past we're trying to make a better false self, a happier false me.
Mm-hmm.
But this comes what is prior to me and my story.
Yeah.
Who are you before the idea of I am the body?
Yes.
When you ask that question, mm-hmm. if you need a reason for why it works, mm-hmm. is that it immediately removes that reference point, the I, the false I. And the veil drops. And, you know, it may be only a glimpse.
Yes.
And this is actually quite normal for people. You know, they may have a glimpse of this, a satori perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
But if they will continue with this one simple question, free to everybody to ask, that altered state of consciousness within your presence, not quite right there, right? Within your presence,
yeah.
Dissolves.
Mm-hmm.
And the pure I alone remains. Okay. No separation. And everything is this. Our old life was concerned with our, perhaps, nature, with all that can be contacted by the physical senses.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the body's beautiful and key for initial awakening, but who are you prior to the body experience? Who is this I? And if you will ask this question, and instead of seeking enlightenment, actually
just
seek
ask
that.
This question. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Who is that?
Mm-hmm.
Follow it home.
Mm-hmm.
To where it never left.
Yeah.
You know, always here.
So let's go back for a moment, Katie. So when this experience happened, or when the shift happened of your perception, did you know what was going on?
I had no idea what was going on.
How did you find out? You said you didn't read, never read books.
Well, I didn't even know what to call it.
What caused it?
What to call it. Right. You know, you need at least awakening or enlightenment or self-realization.
Yes.
To go looking for a guide. But you see, that was the blessing of it. It was impossible to pick up concepts or any beliefs. I looked for spiritual teachers and met with them, and clergy, and psychologists, and even psychiatrists, to ask, you know, this question, what has happened? And also to communicate, you know, that just as we wake up from a nightmare and feel completely relieved to discover that we've only been dreaming, everyone can wake up from this daytime dream of the mind to realize that who we actually are and have forever been, completely beyond this divided mind, its emotions, and the body.
It was interesting because when that happened to you, you went through quite a rough time. You know, your identity was stolen, and that is interesting, you know, experience with what happened. And your daughter had a car accident, and you lost your business.
Yes, there is the falling apart.
Was completely falling apart. And
Or rather than, now I can look at that those were not times of destruction, but rather more like the cocoon of the butterfly falling away.
Yes, yes.
You know, the greater life that we are just made way for the new.
Mm.
Every aspect of my life transformed. We don't go about transforming our life situation to be in alignment as this. It naturally transforms because you're no longer looking through this veil. So really, if we can realize who we ultimately are, then the life situation and what we used to think of as the person only, all transforms by itself. So there's not one thing. Is the second you pick up the idea that you think that you can do something, that's the ultimate obstruction.
Yes, I just wanted to say the only thing we have to let go is the doer.
Yes.
Yeah, the one who is constantly doing.
You know, the word I, this one letter word, we use it all of the time, and there's of course no problem in that.
Yeah.
So, but it's the misidentification when you take that mental concept and think that that is who you are. You don't have to get any further for the pain gap to be there. You're this magnificent heart of all being, and then choose to misidentify with this tiny fraction that will always be a fraction, no matter how many other things or people, other fragments that you try to add to yourself in order to come up with this sense of completion, they can always leave you. Or you'll have to have more fragments to make you feel whole. So the ego is always under this sense of threat or desire to gain more. And of course that pain gap that I'm speaking of then creates this perception of the world, one of suffering. What I would really like everyone to hear is that this is the end of all suffering, and it's fully available to every human being right now. It doesn't require 25 years in a hidden cave in the Himalayan mountains. You cannot learn who you are. It's beyond perception. I am beyond cognition. We can only simply be still, of course, before the awakening. We'll go back just a moment again to that ego, that time-based self, who is always in either the past and projecting the same past into the future. You know, it's just a vicious circle.
Right.
And if we can step out of time by being the body fully and being present, then we have the opportunity to discover the infinite self that we truly are. It's not a trivial matter. You know, if as we realize who we are, there, the world is then transformed. You know, if it's the end of all suffering, this is available for the world.
It seems something is happening in the moment. I mean, we had Gangaji here a few weeks ago, and she said, this is the time of the ordinary awakening. You know, where it just happens, this awakening happens to normal lay people who never heard anything about it. And so I guess...
We've been traveling since 1999.
Yes.
And have been willing to meet with anyone who is interested or can listen.
Yes.
And it is true that people in all walks of life are waking up to this essential truth, truly essential truth.
Yes.
It's alive. It's flourishing. And I could even say inevitable and unavoidable. So it's more of a question, would you like to be prepared?
You know. I think prepare, I mean, what I understand is the importance of just be quiet sometimes. Yes. And sit and listen. Mm-hmm. And just be with yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And of course, if you're sitting silently, perhaps in nature,
yeah,
you know, the mind will still ramble on and on through association. I remember being here before, but I didn't really like the person I was here with.
Yes.
You know, and all the psychology. You see, this is what drops. It's that psychological self that is at the end of it. Mm-hmm. But if you can really be there with the body and nature and use the sounds that you hear, the birds singing in the distance or a babbling brook or eyesight just watching, you know, a little leaf tremble in the wind. Mm-hmm. It's impossible to be in your mind.
It's true, yeah.
When the mind's in attention, it doesn't think, and you're fully in the body. Mm-hmm. And then you can follow those sounds or sights back into the stillness. You never have to leave stillness. It's always here. It can't truly be covered up. But if you identify with I, you know, all of the armor comes up. Mm. We're not giving up anything. There's no diminishment here. I think that's sometimes misunderstood.
Yeah. So, when this happened to you, it was the background became the foreground, and the foreground moved away. And yet you mention in the book you had several years, it took you several years of integration. So I do not quite understand when you were identified with who you are, what, and the I basically was gone. What was integrating, or what was the part of integration?
Yes, of course, so you see there's still some duality there.
Yes.
Some separation.
Yes.
Otherwise there wouldn't be anything to integrate with.
That's right.
But there was this profound bliss and stillness, and the world appeared almost like a heat haze, if you will. Mm-hmm. A complete dream. And for whatever reason, and perhaps this has always been so, more likely than not, mm-hmm. there's an opportunity to integrate this so that we don't have a source from which all else flows.
Yeah.
You know, there's separation in that. There is only this. There's the deep, still formlessness that's dancing everywhere within form, constantly changing. But we've only shifted in identity. You know, you haven't truly given up the body. You haven't yeah. given up anything. The only thing that is ultimately, in the end, surrendered is suffering and separation. And you can still see that.
So,
you know, as the mind acts out. We were sitting just last night here in London, and these two men started walking down the street, and I heard them coming quite a ways away, because one was yelling. It almost sounded like, you know, there was some type of argument. But as he approached, I realized he was simply talking about his work situation. And here are these lovely flowers and these baskets under the windows and the trees with the leaves on them. It was twilight, beautiful time of evening. And he was with a friend, and he was just yelling about everything that had happened at work. And I'm not saying this in any judgmental kind of way. Mm. It's just the perfect example of this pain body, the psychological pain. Mm-hmm. And yet there's all this love and beauty surrounding him. His friend was, you know, kind of shoulders up and listening. But his opportunity there could have been to feel the evening, to feel the breeze on the skin, to recognize the deep connection with a friend. But instead, he was into his story of the psychological self, that separate identity that it needs conflict. And of course, it was a past story. But it had nothing to do with the beautiful walk that he was on with his lovely friend. And you could just see the insanity of it.
But how do you see conflict? I mean, there is conflict in the world. There are wars and, you know, things are happening which are not beautiful. How does reality look for you?
Beautiful.
And this aspect.
And just like this gentleman walking down the street, identified and still hypnotized by the collective... Well, consciousness, we could call it unconsciousness.
Yes.
It'd be more accurate. You can see the wars and the violence. But are you looking through a veil of separation? Where are you looking from becomes extremely important. Mm-hmm. You know, if you are separate, an individualized sense of self only...
Yes.
You're going to see nothing but separation.
And suffering.
Me and my country versus you and your country.
Yeah.
And then we have the conflict of war. We can step out of all of that. Not in the future. No. It's available now. Mm-hmm. But it's not fixing the world, you see. We leave the world alone. We leave the individual life story alone, and we discover who we are, and it effortlessly unfolds. So I see it as a time of miracles, a new dawn, as I referred to it in the book. Mm-hmm. It isn't really new, because it's been forever here. And we have only to become conscious of it. And it's within us.
And then you met Sundance.
Yes. Yes. And that was beautiful, to meet someone as beloved who had been through awakening. And so finally this had a name.
So he could, you could talk with, you could share with him.
Right.
Your experience.
And an opportunity of wise love and living that in a day-to-day ordinary, which becomes quite extraordinary, you know, every moment of life. And as it turned out, we ended up sharing this and teaching together. It's beautiful.
Yes. It's interesting when you called it wise love.
Yes. It's not at all like the relative love that turns to hate in an instant.
Yes, yes. So how does wise love look like?
It has no
in
form.
Daily life.
It has no form. It arises from this intelligence that you are. You are this wise love. And when you consider that you have, I don't know about you, but Katie, I was looking for it everywhere.
Yes.
And you are this. And it flows from within. It can't be found in the world of form. We bring it into the world of form, which isn't ultimately quite true either. There's always the paradox. But if we will just, like you said, stop and be still and watch what arises, you know, first we're going to see all kinds of thoughts, and thoughts can be quite mad.
Yeah, it is a madhouse.
And if you miss the thoughts, which in the beginning can be quite difficult, to even, because you're so identified with the thought, that you're not even aware that you're thinking compulsively almost all of the time. Not you, but people in general. And so again, if you're in the body, you're going to be aware of the emotions. And they're more easy to see. You know, if anger comes up, you know what the mind's been up to. if you miss the thoughts, you'll recognize them as some type of negative emotion. It doesn't need to be profound. It could be something like stress or worry or just a general sense of unease.
So is anger still coming up sometimes?
No.
No
emotions.
You can
be free of this.
Because we, you know, we have had so many non-duality people here. That's how they call themselves. And they would say, yeah, anger is coming up and this is coming up, but there isn't anybody there who is doing something with it. So what you say is that that all was
well
running.
This awakening occurred 23 years ago.
Yeah.
That's a very long time.
It's a long time.
And when I speak of integration in the natural transmutation.
Yes.
Or transformation, if you will, of the life story. You know, there's no, even there, you know, there, you can't jump in and say, well, now I'm going to go through integration. There you've set yourself back in the trap. But I can only share with what, you know, I found
what you,
to be
what you,
true.
Sure. So your personality never comes up anymore?
Sure.
I'm just curious how...
Well, let's find out first. What do you mean by personality?
Well, I would say the personality is the programmed self, which also the inhabits the ego structure.
And you use those conditioned patterns in order to what?
Well, it's not that I use them. It's like they are a driving force in life.
So you're aware of these conditioned patterns?
Yes.
Okay, so actually you are already beyond them. You're watching them operate. Is that true?
Yes.
Yeah. So it's sort of like a tail of a comet.
Yes, so...
It passes on its own accord.
Yeah.
And they're harmless unless you identify with them. But before you identify with them, meaning the conditioned patterns, what was prior to that was that you identified with I, that is the body.
Right.
The initial separation.
Yes.
And with that I, you can imagine all of the conditioned patterns throughout a lifetime that we have learned in order to get what we want, in order to escape what we don't like. You know, the ego is very manipulative. It wants to be in control and it thinks it can get it. And the funniest thing is that it isn't even there. If you search for it, it's not there. So watching these conditioned patterns that we're calling at this moment personality, you can already see that you're beyond it. Or you wouldn't be aware of it.
That's right, yeah.
So if you're aware of the personality and how it operates, whether it's a happy self or an unhappy self, or what it's after, or what it wants, the second you're aware of it, you can clearly see that you're beyond it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I see with people who are awakening. It's just a matter of looking from an ever deeper level of who you are. And once no reference points remain, I suppose we could call that self-realization. Actually, I would save self-realization for the full embodiment. Again, I'm not speaking of the individual body here, though. It doesn't exclude the individual body. You know, it's the appearance of the universe. Formlessness that is appearing as consciousness, as all form. Rotating planets. I mean, what kind of intelligence is this? Really? Or that's processing all these functions within our bodies right now. And we can ignore it. The tides and the changing seasons.
I'm getting more and more pulled into the silence. When I was watching when I did the research, I was watching some of the clips on YouTube, and I already then felt this incredible silence emanating from you.
And that's because it's within you, is the truth.
Yes, it's just...
I mean, if I had a hand mirror...
I just want to sit here and be quiet. And I can see in this moment how who speaks is silent. Silence speaks. Yeah, there isn't anybody there.
And the reason you can recognize that is that you are this.
Yeah.
And then we can get together as friends or sit on a couch and discuss whatever. And it is always here, deeply here.
It's another thing I feel in your presence is my heart.
Yes.
And I know in your book you mentioned a lot the heart and consciousness being the heart and
as soon as we say one word we've made it into an object that isn't real. Just something that we essentially are. You know, we live in this a virtual paradise, if you will.
You're right.
A secret garden of stillness that is within and appearing to be without, outside. Mm-hmm. And without that body reference point anymore, you know, there's just this. But it's going so unnoticed. And there's a quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson,
right,
that says, what would you do if the midnight stars only came out once every 1,000 years? You know, would you ignore it or would you watch TV? And this is what I'm asking people. What, you have heard the news here today. What will you do? You got the doer there. You stop. Allow this to arise, this timeless heart that makes all things possible. It makes perception possible at a not so deep level. You see it as perceiving something else, some object.
Mm-hmm.
But it's that which makes perception possible, makes cognition possible, and yet it itself is free.
That's beautiful. And yet it is important that we share ourselves, sometimes we share our stories.
Mm-hmm.
It is important that people can reflect and see that there's something else, and maybe they had an experience and they, like you, they don't know what to do with it, or don't know where it was coming from, or what was happening. So I think it is important sometimes also to talk about the story. And I remember when I used to be able to leave my body and astral travel, and you know, I was doing amazing things, you know, and used it also to heal people. I mm-hmm. could go into other people's bodies, and when I shared that sometimes in my groups, people would come up and were so grateful and said, I have this experience, and I thought I was going crazy, and you know, I went to my doctor and he tried to give me pills.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And as helpful as being together with people, it's not, this realization isn't dependent upon anything.
Yes. You know,
the only answer, I could give conceptual answers all day long, and unless those people look,
yeah,
that you were meeting with, unless they looked within,
yes,
to find out for themselves, and it becomes more knowledge in a basket that we're actually trying to empty.
Empty, yeah, I understand that. But at the same time, Katie, people's mind relax.
Yes.
And this relaxation gives an opening. Mm. And sometimes, you know, we have, you know, it's good to talk about certain things, you know, and it's old concepts, mm, but it can be used as a tool.
Yes, but if there's no sense of self there.
Yeah.
So that's the joy of being human, I guess we could say.
Yeah.
You know, one love. You know, you could get together and read poetry or enjoy a walk in nature, mm-hmm, or talk about spiritual experiences.
Yeah.
The deeper question is, who is that that is experiencing? Who is living here? Who is,
yeah,
being?
That those are the fundamental questions. You know,
is it my being versus your being? You know, the opportunity of people sharing together in groups is just the love that can surface in the silence and the stillness. It's very supportive. A group atmosphere is very supportive of that.
Yes, yeah.
But, you know, I don't know if you've ever just gone into the forest and sat with a tree, have satsang.
Yeah, I loved it.
We don't talk back, you know. It's, you know, it's not an alone truth. It's not meant to be hibernating in the cave that I was speaking of earlier.
Yeah.
Alone. I mean, that's an essential part of the path, is having time alone. But ultimately, it's all of us being, recognizing that we're free enough.
Yeah.
And perfect.
So, just something came up. When we spoke earlier, before the program started, you said the witness left. And there was a what was only left was consciousness, you know, and your personality, and, you know, it was all only consciousness. Does that mean, and I experienced that once, it's not where I live, where it is beyond the mind and you are just experience, you just flow. There's no thinking, there is just a constant creation from one moment to the next.
I mean, you're just relating such a deep level of surrender, and it's so beautiful, you know, flowing with life instead of having an idea. I mean, we're truly present, being it, allowing it to dance through us.
And you think the only thing we have to do is just to be quiet, to go beyond the mind?
You know, the ego often misunderstands this. I was speaking with a woman. She said, but I have a very busy life.
Yeah.
I can't just be sitting and being still. The stillness is who you are, and it's whether you're waiting in a post office line or preparing your dinner or every morning, you know, taking your shower. You know, it's who you are. You're not looking at the level from the mind. You know, that it's all here, all deeply integrated.
So it's connecting with... I mean, and I can feel it now, the silence. And there's no form, it's just silence.
Right. In relationship to consciousness, I'm pure awareness. In relationship to the universe, let's say, I'm pure beingness. But this isn't really a relationship land. You know, we're just... there is only this. And I don't mean that in some existential type of way. You know, the existentialist may have been coming quite close. You know that there's just nothing. But you see, that's the mind calling it nothing. And you can investigate that nothingness, that apparent formlessness. You see, you're still looking there from a point of reference. When that point of reference goes, then there's just essence that is form and form that is essence. Just a beautiful dance.
I
go shopping.
I just feel blank in the moment. That's all there is.
This is the truth.
Would be also easy.
Oh, so easy. It's not to say that you're not going to work hard. In fact, because you're flowing, as you described, so spontaneously, there's not all that consternation of the mind, you know, what needs to happen next. I mean, we still may set goals, you know, make the list of to-do, but, you know, that list to-do is moving toward the future, and you don't know what's going to show up. You may miss your connecting flight. You know, your daughter may be in a car accident. And it's being wherever you are, fully and completely. And it is so much easier to be in acceptance and surrender than fighting it. You know, what are you going to do if you don't want to miss your flight and you've missed the airplane?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's silly to say, well, this shouldn't have happened.
I know.
It is.
Yeah.
I mean, so you flow with that, and you'll find that it's constantly pointing. I mean, we could live by our conditioned intelligence that comes from the separated, divided mind.
Yes.
Or we could be this universal intelligence, as I said earlier, that's capable of... you know, the planets are rotating.
Yeah.
We do nothing. The tides are changing. Could it be that this little teeny life situation is actually happening by itself in this divine perfection?
Yeah.
Instead of the ego pretending to control everything.
Mm.
And that's the simplicity of being.
It's really having the courage to stay with the not knowing and the mystery of the not knowing.
Well, if we were honest and took a look, if we knew what was going to happen 30 seconds from now, or 5 seconds from now, we would have to say that we do not know.
Yeah. Okay, Katie, we have to finish. I just want to show your book again. Katie wrote this book, Awake Joy, The Essence of Enlightenment. And thank you for watching Conscious TV. Goodbye.